Good afternoon. My name is Carlos Jordan, and to begin, I would like to thank the organisers for putting together this important event and for giving me the opportunity to be a part of it. It's fantastic to see such a healthy interest in disability in the ancient world, as well as accessibility in modern museum spaces. I'm a disabled postgraduate student at University College London's Institute of Archaeology, and today I'm going to be talking to you about disability in ancient Egypt, specifically through a case study of a woman we know as Geheset, who is believed to be one of the earliest known cases of a person with cerebral palsy in the ancient world. In telling you about her life and her condition, I intend to put forward to you today my thoughts on the wider discipline's approaches to disability in antiquity and where I, as a disabled scholar, believe our next steps lie in order to further enrich our understanding. Please be aware that this presentation contains 3 slides with human remains. To begin, I believe it's important that we contextualise exactly who Geheset is and where she is in her own space and time, as this will be vital to our interpretation and understanding of her lived experience as a disabled person. Geheset is believed to have lived at some point during the 18th century BCE, a period of time which we often categorise as the late Middle Kingdom, going into the Second Intermediate Period, during which Egypt was ruled by the 13th dynasty. This dynasty, consisting of about 50 pharaohs over the span of approximately 150 years, saw extended periods of quick succession from one pharaoh to the next, with multiple signs of non-familial succession, while at the same time we have multiple attested courtiers who appear constant across multiple reigns. What this means is that during this period, the pharaoh's court was likely in varying states of flux as the kingdom's power gradually declined. At some point, the court moved from Ichtawe in Middle Egypt, which you can see underlined in red here near the top of the map just east of the Fayum Oasis, some 373 miles south to Thebes in Upper Egypt, down towards the bottom of the map underlined in brown, as the Nile Delta, which feeds into the Mediterranean Sea, came under the control of the peoples referred to as the Hyksos. Geheset, then, lived during a time of significant social and political fluctuation. This is important for Geheset's story because she was married to a man named Ameni, who we know was a judge at the court. Geheset, therefore, was a woman of high status. As lady of the household, Geheset would have moved and socialised through the court in the midst of these fluctuations and the geographical transfer of power from one end of Egypt to another. It has also been suggested that Geheset may have been of Nubian birth, based on the analysis of her remains. While it should be noted that this is by no means conclusive, I mention it because it may suggest her experience of space in her lifetime was not just confined to Kemet, as Egypt was conceived at the time. Geheset was approximately 50 to 60 years old when she died. Shortly after, she was mummified and interred in a shaft burial at the royal necropolis of Dra Abu el-Nagar on the west bank of Thebes. Her body was discovered in 2004 during excavations led by Daniel Pohls of the German Archaeological Institute. Here on the left we see a map of the west bank of Thebes with Dra Abu el-Nagar's position highlighted in red. It's important to see where Geheset resided within this sacred landscape. For the Egyptians, death was a transition from a mortal life to an immortal one, reborn as one of the beautiful dead. As we can see, her resting place exists within the same liminal space as the mortuary temples that sit at the boundaries of the green and fertile land of the living, while beyond, within the wadis and rocky mountain passes, the land of the dead rests, veiled away. Geheset was buried here much earlier than most of these landmarks, but the fact that it became a continual site of burial demonstrates the evolving significance of the landscape, and as the landscape evolved, those interred before, Geheset included, became part of its significance, its sacredness. On the right, we see a drawing of the northeastern part of Abu el-Nagar, with shaft K03.4, Geheset's tomb, outlined in bold red. This same area became the resting place of Nup-Kheperar-Intef, a pharaoh of the later 17th dynasty, and several of his retainers. As we can see, Geheset not only held a high status in life, but also in death, as she maintains a close proximity to the royal household. At some point between her interment over 3,800 years ago and her rediscovery in 2004, her burial was disturbed by looters who tried to plunder the tomb of all its contents. The looters managed to take most of what was there, and in the process of looting they removed Geheset's mummy from her resting place within the coffin, leaving us very few material traces of what was buried with her aside from some remnants of pottery, cattle bones, and fragments of the assemblage. The looters, however, either failed or neglected to take the coffin itself. And this is fortunate for us because the coffin is perhaps the richest demonstration of the significance Geheset had in life and in death. There are in fact two coffins, an outer coffin and an inner coffin. On the outside, they appear quite similar to the coffins that we recognise in the Middle Kingdom, but there are some details which are unique to Geheset's coffins. Significant is the fact that on the interior of the outer coffin there are extensive passages and spells of spells and magical formula to assist the coffin's occupant, Geheset, in navigating the other world. In the picture on the right, you can see how richly decorated the interior of Geheset's outer coffin was, covering every available space. There are two things which make this case particularly noteworthy. First, coffin texts are not common during the period when this coffin was built. Therefore, we can see a unique case of evolving burial practices. Second, it is not just the presence of these texts that is important, but their wording. Geheset's coffin is believed to be one of the earliest known artifacts to be inscribed with passages that would later appear in books for the dead, a later development of funerary texts that began to appear from the New Kingdom onwards. This outer coffin, then, was incredibly valuable, not just in material terms, but spiritually as well. All the more remarkable then when the outer inscriptions tell us that the coffin was originally built for Ameni, but he rededicated it to Geheset. All that being said, what has made Geheset herself remarkable to Egyptologists has been the paleopathological study of her remains. So let us take a very quick look at Geheset's body. Based on the results of the paleopathological analysis, Geheset has been diagnosed as having had cerebral palsy, which refers to a group of neurological muscular conditions that can affect a person's muscle movement, mobility, balance, and posture. Cerebral palsy is a non-genetic congenital condition and is the most common motor disability for children today. The first piece of evidence identified is the presence of temporomandibular arthritis. This refers to arthritis that affects the joint where the jaw meets the skull. Geheset seems to have used the left side of her mouth more heavily when chewing and swallowing, hence the high level of abrasion on the teeth to the left as opposed to the right, and the pitted abrasion of the left temporomandibular joint, while the right shows no such wear. A likely reason for this could be some form of paresis, muscular weakness, in the right side of Geheset's face that would have caused her to favour the left side of her mouth. The second piece of evidence we have is the very clear sign of muscle and joint hyperflexivity in Geheset's left hand. Due to the mummification process, a portion of the soft tissue and skin on the hand is intact and we can see how it's shaped around the joints, which tells us that this was not caused by any kind of post-mortem activity. This is reinforced by x-rays, which reveal that several bones within the fingers have reduced density, suggesting very little use during Geheset's growth and lifetime. People with cerebral palsy tend to be affected by one or both of two further conditions, dyskinesia and ataxia. Dyskinesia refers to involuntary muscular contractions and contortions, which can lead to the involuntary movement of the limbs, hands and feet, as well as body tremors. Ataxia, on the other hand, was described to me by my fellow disabled colleague Alexandra Morris as an uncoordinated wide-based gait and can also result in changes in speech and difficulties eating and swallowing. If we take a look at Geheset's mandibular teeth, we see heavy depositions of calculus as the result of excess levels of saliva, a symptom common for people with ataxic cerebral palsy. With the temporomandibular arthritis, the hyperflexation of the left hand, and the evidence for ataxia, I think we can be reasonably confident that Geheset had cerebral palsy, and that this played a part in her lived experience as a noblewoman in late Middle Kingdom Egypt, certainly noteworthy in its own right. While Geheset's disability is important for us to recognise in order to understand her, its presence alone cannot tell us about her entire lived experience. Unfortunately, larger trends in the study of disability in antiquity have led to conclusions that the presence of disability in and of itself is enough to characterise and therefore draw conclusions about the lived experiences of a disabled person, as if the disability alone is enough to interpret their lives. Previous scholars have concluded that Geheset was marred by gross asymmetry, that she was unusual, and that her clinical features alone were the reason for her high social status. She is used as an example of survival of the weakest, based purely on the presence of her disability. Even when she receives recognition for being Lady of the Household, her status is starkly contrasted with the severity of her disability. As a disabled scholar, I unequivocally reject these approaches and the conclusions that have been drawn as a result. The presence or absence of disability is not necessarily determinative of a certain type or quality of life. While the presence of disability is significant and doubtlessly would have played a role in the lived experiences of the ancient peoples who had them, disability is far too broad a spectrum to be so easily categorized in any form of a totality. This is true even for when we're dealing with cases of the same disability. I have cerebral palsy, but can only, at best, embody a sliver of what Geheset's lived experience must have been. But what I can tell you, as a disabled person speaking to you today, is that disability is not a simple binary of what can and can't be done. It is another means of being and becoming, shaped by a multitude of other experiences both from within and without. I do not believe the experience in the past was any less complex, nor do I believe it's impossible for us to at least attempt to reconstruct it. In rejecting the appearance of disability in an ancient person's life as being the sole determinative of their experience, we should seek to understand their personhood, their agency, and forms of embodiment. I will go on to discuss each of these in turn. Just as non-disabled people in antiquity had a broad range of experiences, so too did disabled people, and we must see them within the wider context of their times and spaces in order to see that. We cannot generalize these experiences. Geheset is just one case study, exceptional for a multitude of reasons. We can never know her life with absolute certainty, but by simply considering these multitudes, I believe what we can be certain of is that disability was part, and not the sole determinative of, her life. Personhood, an individual's idea of themselves and their place in the world with others, is the first key to unlocking our perception of the ancient disabled person's lived experience. Who did they identify as? What do we know about their relationships with other people? How did those relationships influence their place in the societies in which they lived? To illustrate how we can begin to conceptualize Geheset's personhood, and how we can contextualize that with her disability, I'll draw a comparison with another disabled person of high status from ancient Egypt. Seneb, whose name means healthy, was a man with dwarfism and a member of the royal court during the late 4th dynasty of the Old Kingdom. We know from his mastaba at Giza that he was a wealthy man, which attests he owned several thousand herds of cattle. He also held some 20 honorific titles: overseer of weaving in the palace, overseer of dwarfs, overseer of the ceremonial barge, just to name a few, and was a priest of Wajet. We also know that he was married. His wife, Senetites, was a priestess of Hathor and Neit, and they had 3 children together. Some 37 individuals in total are named in his tomb. His name and those of his family are also attested in the mastabas of others, including potential relatives, in his cemetery. From all this we can draw a picture of Seneb's personhood. His name, potentially given to him at birth, is an affirmation to lead a life full of vigour. His wealth and titles, the former possibly inherited while the latter were attained throughout his lifetime, are demonstrations of his social significance, an active role within the life of the court. His relationships as a husband, father, son, authority figure, companion to the pharaoh, and many more, show Seneb as someone with an assured sense of his place as an individual and with others. While his dwarfism was significant in his life, his representations clearly don't omit it, as we can see from the pictures on the right. It certainly does not encapsulate the total depth of his personhood. So what does this mean for Geheset? Even in her case, where we are unfortunately denied such vivid biographical detail, I believe we can work with the details we do have to construct some idea of her personhood. Her marriage to Hermeni, and position subsequently as Lady of the Household, tells us that she was recognized as a wife and that she too had an active presence, not just in managing the household, but in navigating social relationships with other members of the court. Her name, Geheset, means gazelle. Animal names for people are attested in ancient Egypt, and what they mean is up for debate. Whether this name was given to her from birth, or perhaps a name that she chose to adopt, my hypothesis is this. Gazelles, in the Egyptian worldview, are part of a class of wild animal that represent the inherent, but necessary, chaos of the natural world. Geheset's name, then, may be an identification with this form of chaos. And while to us that may sound negative, I would argue not so, and to expand on this point we should consider agency. An individual's active participation, influence, and effect on the people and world around them is the next key to unlocking our perceptions. What did that person do during their lifetime? How did that influence and affect them and their relationships? What challenges may they have faced, and how did they overcome them? As Ameni's wife and as a lady of the household, she would have been an active member of the pharaoh's court. The court mustn't be imagined as purely a physical space or bound to Pharaoh's political power exclusively. It was a tightly choreographed social network in which relationships were created and maintained within the secret and intimate orbit of Pharaoh's life. It was not something in any way analogous to a modern-day government. While administrative and military officials were present within the court, many more were ceremonial and existed within the space as companions of Pharaoh as they exercised their power. But just as Pharaoh exercised their power and influence, so too could the people in that sphere use and cultivate their own. Geheset's role as Lady of the Household didn't just mean she was responsible for managing the logistics of her household, but in building and cultivating relationships with other households. This was done through lavish social activities such as feasting, meant to entertain, impress, and build close relationships. These relationships would have empowered both Geheset and Ameni in their daily lives and in their navigation of the fluctuating court landscape of their day. I also think we should consider Geheset's marriage to Ameni more closely. What we know of marriage in ancient Egypt is based on its representation in literature and in inscription, and the picture that gets painted is quite intricate. While the husband can be seen as the one to initiate the marriage and the engagement, that may not always be the case, and the wife's continued independence in decision-making is advised in wisdom literature. We don't know how Ameni and Geheset's courtship began, but it's possible that it could have begun with the context of the court, possibly at the behest of Pharaoh, which we have multiple attestations of happening. Geheset could have influenced this herself too, by creating an impression that caught Ameni's, the Pharaoh's, or both's eyes. That impression, I believe, may have come from how she navigated the anxiety caused by byproducts of her disability. Think back to the evidence that showed Geheset produced excess saliva, possibly due to her ataxia. In ancient Egypt, all fluids of the body were considered magically imbued components, and of the same nature as the waters of the Nile itself, and any uncontrolled production of this could be seen as quite dangerous. The Edwin Smith papyrus, which is a medical papyrus dating from the Second Intermediate Period, so not too far removed from Geheset's time, denotes excess saliva as a potential sign of morbidity, yet Geheset was clearly not shunned for this. I would argue it empowered her, and this comes back to what I said earlier about her name suggesting an identity with the natural chaos of the world. Since this was a constant that she would have dealt with throughout her life, and no doubt culturally aware of the connotations that held, actively addressing it through care would have eased those anxieties for all those who partook in it, potentially Pharaoh included. This would have been significant for the times that she was living in. With the court's power in actively in flux, having someone who embodies the natural chaos that is necessary to perpetuate order and caring for them helps bring that sense of stability in the face of trying times. I have no doubt Geheset was conscious of this, and rather than being a passive subject, was an active participant. This brings us to our final key, embodiment. Seeing the body not just as an object of biological curiosity, but as its own landscape shaped and defined by lived experiences. What effect do different kinds of embodiment have on the body? How do we begin to conceptualize their senses of the world around them and within? What could their considerations for the life beyond tell us about their embodiment? Here I mostly want to pose some open questions to you all for your consideration, as all these different things deserve much closer consideration than I can offer in the time that we have left together. Geheset's embodiment and lived experience of disability was not separate from all of her other embodiments, so we ought to consider them in tandem. What were her experiences as a woman, in a society where fertility, life-giving, and motherhood were culturally significant? Living into her 60s, how can we contextualize her embodiment within the evidence we have for the conception and experience of aging in ancient Egypt? How did her high social status affect her bodily experience, with the extra comforts and mobility it likely afforded her? Her potential Nubian birth may suggest experiences of movement and migration too, so what could those experiences tell us? We could go further, considering her experiences of the senses, not just solely in terms of sound, sight, smell, touch and taste, but also in terms of her sense of space and the environment in which she lived. What were her experiences of domestic space? What would it have been like for her to be hosting or a guest at a private feast? What types of food would she have been eating, keeping in mind her ataxia, for example? Same with her experience of time. With what we know about the Egyptian calendar, with its many festivals and seasons of flooding, growth and harvest, how may she have experienced those changing seasons and the passing of time? Thinking of all these things I've just mentioned, how might we begin to conceive of her own experiences of her body and the stresses it endured? Did she medicate herself, and if so, what medications, from what we know about Egyptian medicine, may she have taken? The mind and the body are inextricably linked too. What might histories of emotion in Egyptian thought tell us about their experiences of pain, but also changes, both anticipated and not? The passage on the right is from the Instructions of Amenemhope, a wisdom text which begins to appear in the New Kingdom and which is a set of instructions to Amenemhope's son from his father, instructing him on how to lead a pious and successful life in the face of hard circumstances. The first three lines of this particular chapter are often used as evidence of disability acceptance in ancient Egypt, but I feel it's the following lines that tell us the most about their attitudes. Man is clay and straw, and God is his potter. He overthrows and he builds daily. He impoverishes 1,000 if he wishes, but he makes 1,000 into officials. When he is in his hour of life, how fortunate is he who reaches the west when he is safe in the hand of God. This, I believe, demonstrates a belief that the body is ultimately a malleable and ever-changing construct, that the lived experience is one which will continually challenge you and transform you as time goes on. Nothing is constant and nothing is for granted until you reach the land of the West, the land of the dead. Finally, therefore, I think it's particularly important for Egyptologists to never forget the significance of the death experience for ancient Egyptians and their concerns and preparations for their embodiment in eternity. Far too often, our approaches to the mummified body are about trying to unravel the secrets of their life, forgetting that the ritual process of becoming a mummified person was a transformation into something new, and not just a simple preservation of who they were in life. This transformation is into an idealized, beautified form, but I feel as though sometimes we make the assumption that such an idea suggests a normative ideal of beauty. Remember Geheset's left hand. None of that was caused by post-mortem activity, nor was there any attempt to seemingly correct it. It is part of her for eternity. Nobody seems to have considered that. So to conclude, I again want to stress that the point of this talk wasn't to try and build a definitive biography of Geheset's life. We can never know her life with absolute certainty. It bears repeating also that Geheset, Seneb, and many other ancient disabled people are exceptional for their own reasons, so we can never really effectively generalize their experiences. But what I hope I have demonstrated to you today is that by simply attempting to consider a broader context for Geheset's life, I've disproven any notion that her life was in some way reduced by, or shaped solely because of, her disability. She was not a high-status woman simply because she was disabled. She was not a high-status woman in spite of being disabled. She was a high-status woman and disabled. By not assuming the meaning and significance of disability from the beginning, and instead considering it within the context of her time and space, of her own personhood, agency, and sense of embodiment, we may just be able to begin to envision how multifaceted her life was as a disabled woman in ancient Egypt truly was. I'd like to leave you with this. On the right you can see two pairs of Ujjat eyes from the coffins of Geheset. The top pair are on the interior of the outer coffin, and the bottom pair are on the exterior of the inner coffin. When they are properly assembled, the two line up. The Ujjat eyes symbolize the cosmos and eternity, and were the portal through which the coffin's occupant could see and follow the rising of the sun in the east to witness the eternal cycle of rebirth. It has been suggested that the lighter irises represent Imeni's eyes, while the darker irises represent Geheset's. Clearly, Imeni cared immensely for Geheset's eternal life, and his rededication inscription tells us this explicitly. She's not the gross Geheset. She's not the unusual Geheset. She's not the severely disabled Geheset. She is, to evoke the ancient Egyptian, Heshemetef, Merejetef, Lebet Per Geheset, his beloved wife and lady of the household, Geheset. Thank you for listening. I look forward to your questions.